nothing else matters. My feet in the stirrups, I'm so happy. There's nothing like the sound of Carolina hoofbeats.
And welcome North Carolina at Carolina Bit Company with Curt Leonard. And Curt actually makes bits for your horses. So we're going to learn today what all goes into making a bit for your horse. So Curt, before we start, tell us a little bit about how you got involved in bit making.
Back about 25 years ago, my wife wanted a barrel race, and at the time you couldn't really find what bits you needed, so I kind of started out of necessity.
Right.
And it just kind of evolved from there. It got to, it got more time consuming than my job did, so I had to quit and go into this.
Right. So you've been able to really fine tune bit making to what the customer wants exactly.
Yes, I can make whatever anybody wants.
Okay. So you've been doing this about 25 years?
Yes, full time about 25. I've been doing it a little longer than that.
But, wow. Yeah. And what's the bit made out of, basically?
I make mine out of stainless steel and some sweet iron, but mainly stainless steel.
Okay. And now that you're doing that, do you do them for a specific genre, or do you do them for whatever people would like?
Mainly barrel racing.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But I'll do for whatever anybody wants.
Okay. So they can kind of adjust the length of the shank, or have no shank, or
you can draw
if
it
they
out
want
and give
copper.
Me measurements,
or,
okay. I can do it.
Mm-hmm. All right. Yep. Well, let's see what all's involved in this. This
all
is
right.
going to be exciting.
I'll pick me some rings here, the size that I need. I make all of these at one time, so it's not so time-consuming.
Right.
Let's see. Where's my pen? Got the size.
So that starts out as a long piece of stainless steel that,
12
that
foot.
You buy
yep.
up here. And then you just cut whatever length they want for the shank or the mouthpiece or whatever.
Yes.
Okay.
Come over here and bend it. Make sure it fits my pattern.
And did you make your patterns?
Oh yeah, it's about wore out. Time for a new one. All right, we just need to weld it.
Okay.
Got that tacked together. That's the first part.
So do you have to cool the metal or temper it?
No. I bend everything cold. The only time it gets heated is when I weld it. Mm-hmm. If I heat this and bend it, it would tend to bend a little easier. Mm-hmm. But it's better to do it cold.
Okay. And so you're making this piece now?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that's what we're going to...
Okay.
Wait a minute. Show it again.
This twisted wire mouthpiece.
All right.
Okay. Oh, that's cool. You put the loop in it at the same time you twist it.
Mm-hmm. Yep. On the small ones, I can do that. On the larger ones, I have to weld them together.
Right. Now, Curt makes that look really easy, but having been a jeweler in the past, that takes a little skill to know how tight to pull it and how fast to turn it.
If you just hook that up and turn it, it'll end up in a wad.
Oh, yeah, or slung across the room. Yep. Yeah, I remember those days.
Oh, yeah. A lot of people want to help me, but it's hard to tell somebody how to do this.
Right, it's feel.
Yep.
If you're interested in a career working with horses, then Martin Community College is the place for you. MCC's Equine Technology Program is the only one offered among North Carolina's 58 community colleges. The program is management-oriented with classes in breeding, nutrition, training, riding, equine health, and more. Graduates can leave MCC prepared to work in recreational and racing barns, breed-to-discipline-oriented farms, or assistant farm management. For more information, contact Martin Community College today.
You've worked hard and carefully planned your career. You've built your business. Shouldn't your farm's appearance reflect who you are, your success? Like a timeless work of art to be your legacy, handed down through your generations. Let TNT Lawn Care design, install, and maintain a landscape to reflect who you've become. With our uncompromising attention to detail, we deliver high value in a competitive market. Call TNT Lawn Care today, 336-574-0410.
What kind of welder do you use?
This is a TIG welder.
Okay.
I feed the wire in by hand and it uses a gas.
Uh-huh.
It don't leave any splatter.
Right.
Thank you. Okay. Two bottom rings. Shape this mouthpiece. Okay, that's what it looks like right when I get done welding.
Okay.
And then I've got a big tumbler in the basement that I put them in.
Mm-hmm.
And they come out looking like this. I used to do it by hand, but it takes 10 times as long to polish it as it does to make it.
For sure.
Yep. And then they still don't look as good, but this polisher I got, it's got like about 2,000 pounds of steel shot in it.
Mm-hmm.
And I can put 40 at a time in.
Right.
And they polish for 12 hours at a time. So I usually turn it on at night and then I'll come in the morning and, mm-hmm. and dump it. But that's how that's done.
Right, that's really cool. So this is the finished product.
Yes.
And then people can have it with copper coating on it or rubber or whatever kind of stuff that they want.
I don't do rubber. I can do copper, stainless, sweet iron.
What is sweet iron?
Just plain old rusty metal. Same thing horseshoes may have.
Okay. Mm-hmm. All right. Yep. And then they can determine how long they want the shank and how wide this has to be.
Purchase, yes.
Mm-hmm. Now, I know that there's 5 points that the bits affect a horse. Mm-hmm. So can you talk to me about that a little bit?
Well, you got the nose, the chin, the bars, the roof of the mouth.
And the pole?
Most bits don't really affect the pole.
Okay.
Now, if you use a gag type bit,
like
the ones I'm making those little wires here for,
mm-hmm.
that pulls on the pole.
Okay.
But the main thing is the bars and the chin and the palate, the roof of the mouth.
Mm-hmm.
And then if you use a nose band, then you go to the nose.
Okay.
My name is Scott Brookins, and I am the owner of Brookins Construction and MD Barnmaster of the Carolinas. At MD Barnmaster, we have the best warranty in the business. We have a variety of designs to choose from. Our barns are easily customizable to meet your needs. We have financing available to those who qualify. Our barns are fire resistant, and they hold their value with little maintenance. Let us build your dream barn for you today.
Hi, I'm Rick Peniston. I trained my horse Jake to trust me and be brave in order to face the obstacle challenges and win in extreme cowboy races. It takes dedication, hard work, and innovation to train a champion. As an attorney representing injured persons, I use the same skills to win compensation for people injured in accidents or on-the-job injuries. If you've been injured in an accident or on the job and need advice, call me. I want to hear from you.
And how long the shanky is determines how much pressure you're putting on the horse's mouth?
The length of the shank and the purchase.
What's
the distance
purchase?
Between here and here, okay, and here and here, that's your leverage ratio.
Mm-hmm.
If you move this up this way, it'll be a whole lot more severe.
Okay.
This here determines your shoulder movement.
Mm-hmm.
A longer purchase, you can control the shoulders better.
Mm-hmm.
A shorter purchase, you just got more woe.
Okay. Well, that's good to know.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Okay. Very good.
This little bit here has got a lot of gag.
Okay.
That just slows down your reaction time. If you got a horse that don't like you to grab him in a hurry, this kind of slows it down. It also, I personally don't like gag. I wanna feel it, mm-hmm, you know, right when I get it.
I apologize because bits is the subject I am least versed in. Most everything else I have a working knowledge, but I, like I say, my horses don't need nothing but a little simple nothing.
Some of the most famous riders out there know nothing about bits.
Yeah, I know.
And they want me to tell them what to use. And how do I tell some girl that's won several $1 million what bit she needs?
Yeah, I mean, you until know? You feel her hands in your mouth, you can't answer that question. I mean, that's
you know,
hard.
I want to help, but I'm not riding your horse. I don't really
know.
If you give me an idea, I can point you in the right direction.
Right. So let's talk about the hackamore.
All right, this is the hackamore. It doesn't have a mouthpiece. It just works on the nose and on the chin.
Mm-hmm.
If you got a horse that's his tongue is being cut or is just really damaged, this usually works good. It's not harsh at all.
Right.
Horses tend to not be as bendy with a hackamore.
Good trail riding bit?
It's a good trail riding, and it's good for brow racing too if you got one of the type horses that just overbends or you need to stay out of his mouth.
Mm-hmm.
It works good for that.
Okay. So if I ride my horse with this, and I say, I told you I knew nothing about this. But if I ride my horse with this and I mm-hmm. say, okay, he won't turn as fast as I want him to turn, how, you know, you can make whatever adjustment you think I need based on how I ride him and
yes,
how he rides.
Usually if I can see a picture or a video or something, I can kind of get a close idea
of how he's responding mm-hmm. to what you're currently using.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
And that would make
sometimes
sense.
It's not all in the bit. Sometimes you just need to go back and do a little more homework.
Yeah, yeah.
And it's hard for me to tell somebody that come in and say, what bit's going to make my horse do this?
Right.
And, you know, I hate to tell them I can't tell you that. I think you need to go back and work on this a little bit.
Yeah, it's not a magic wand.
No,
it's only one piece of your toolbox.
Yep.
Definitely.
And sometimes it's in your head, too. If you think that bit's going to make a difference, a lot of times it can because you'll ride different.
Right.
And that'll help.
Right.
You know, I've got a trainer sitting there with 2,000 bits in it, and I can be out in the arena having problems, come up there, switch bits, knowing good and well it's the same type I've got. But in my mind, it's different, so I'll ride different,
mm-hmm.
and it'll make a difference.
And I can see where it would help if I was a trainer training somebody, and I could say, this bit is going to do different. You just need to hold your hands this mm-hmm. way, and then they really didn't need to change the bit. They just need to change
That's
their
right.
hands,
That's
but
right.
it's a good way
That's
to
right.
teach them.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. Right. And on the average, how many bits would you say a person needs in their arsenal when they're trying to barrel race their horse? Do you use different ones for different kinds of courses and the way they're set up?
Not usually. Usually you'll progress through your training through a finished horse as to what type of bit.
Mm-hmm.
Then you get an older horse that gets a little lazy on you or something. You'll need to go back to a different bit to kind of sharpen him up some.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
It's usually, you know, you could probably 10 bits would do everything you need to do.
Okay.
We're your neighborhood source for everything you need from your farm to your home.
At Harper Sales and Service, a division of Harper Landscaping, we can cater to all your mowing needs, whether you need to start out with a beginner series for those smaller lawns, You can work your way all the way up to zero turn and even get into those bigger areas where you might have an acre or two or more.
My animals depend on me, and I depend on Harper Equipment Sales and Services to keep me running. From my weed eater to my tractor, they can fix it all.
When you look for Harper Landscaping, it's no sweat.
Another question for you, because okay. I obviously don't know anything about bits. If I go to a tax store to buy a bit, just any old tax store, and you know they have bits that are $7 and $8 and stuff, obviously they must not be made out of stainless steel.
They can be. It's a different grade. A lot of it you can take and bend by hand. Some of it is going to be chrome steel, which will flake off.
Right.
So you kind of got to watch it. I've got some in just to show people that I could take a, you know, a shank bit like I make and just take it and bend the shanks on it.
And if you're really, you know, serious about your horsemanship, you wouldn't want to put that junk in your horse's mouth either, because if you know, stainless steel is what they make surgical instruments out of and things that go inside your body. Well, yeah, so your horse is much healthier if you use that.
I would rather have stainless. A lot of people like sweet iron, which is just plain rusty metal. Copper, there's a kind of debate on that. They say now that copper burns a horse's mouth. That's why it stays wet, which is the same thing if you put a penny in your mouth. After a while, it'll start burning.
Yeah, that would.
So, you know, I would just stick with stainless.
Mm-hmm.
But everybody's got what they like, and that's why there's so many different bits.
Yeah, that's right. With
one thing that a lot of people get mixed up, I believe, is they want to stay too light. They want to put an O-ring on, and they're standing up in the stirrup pulling, and the horse is pulling. They say, look, my horse is so light, I can ride him in an O-ring. That's not light. Light's when you can hold your fingers, and that horse will do what he needs to do. You put enough bit on there to get what you need without having to put a lot of pressure on it. But people get light mixed up with, you know, a bit that's not much. You know, I would rather overbit my horse and ride easier, you'll do less damage to his mouth than trying to stay light and having to hold on both hands all the time. But that's a big peeve of mine. I was out in Utah several years ago, and as a girl after her run, her horse come out, took her down through the trailers and around the parking lot two or three times, and she come in and said, what do I need? And I showed her a pretty good shank bit. She said, oh no, my horse is much too light for that. You know, if I'd been took through the horse trailer and a couple laps around the parking lot, I wouldn't really care what the horse thought.
Yeah, I mean, he'd understand to stop when I said, whoa, one way or the other. That is funny, because barrel racing folks aren't afraid of nothing. I mean, they're fearless about that stuff.
You know, a lot of times, the first time you put a bit in a horse's mouth, he'll fight it a little bit. You got to give him time to get used to it. Just because the first time you use it don't work, the horse has got to learn how that bit operates.
And what he likes and don't like about it.
Like driving a new car, the first time you get in that car, it don't handle like the old one did, but you get used to it. So the main thing is use enough bit to get what you want without a lot of fight.
That makes good sense. Good advice. So if I see a bit somewhere in a catalog that I'd like, I could send you a picture of it, and you could make it for me too. So your website's CarolinaBitCompany.com. And when I order a bit, how long does it take me to get it, usually?
If I've got it already made up, usually if I'm in town, I can get it out the next day.
Okay.
If it's something custom, usually a week or so.
That's a pretty fast turnaround. All right. Very good. Well, thank you for spending some time with us. I enjoyed learning how to make a bit. Who knew?
Hello, my name is Olivia Jurgens from Cumberland County 4-H Horse Club Thunderhoofs, and I'm here today to determine the best way to see how much body fat is on your horse, and that is called the Hennecke Body Scoring System. This is Diamond, and we are going to determine how much body fat is on his body. So, there are six key body parts you are going to look at. You're going to look at the neck, the shoulders, the withers, the ribs, the loin, and the tail head. So first we're going to look at his neck, and that has a little bit of fat on it, but that's still good for his age because he's 10. Now we're going to look at his withers, And that's pretty muscular. Now we're gonna look at his shoulders. That's pretty muscular too, but it still has a little bit of body fat on it. We're gonna look at his ribs. Now you can still see kind of the outline of them, but they're not bulging with fat, so that's good. Now we're gonna look at his loin, and that is pretty muscular and stiff. Now we're gonna look at his tail head, and that has muscular and a little bit of body fat on it. So we are going to number him a 6. Thank you for watching. Hello, my name is Olivia Jurgens from Cumberland County 4-H Horse Club Thunderhoofs, and I'm here today to teach you the best way to go up and downhill on your horse. When you're going downhill, you're gonna lean back with your heels to the ground and keep one hand on the horn. Ooh. When you lean back, that helps the horse get down the hill not going too fast. You're gonna keep your reins just a little bit loose, but tighter than usual, so you can stop him if he takes off. When you go uphill, you're going to lean forward and your heels are going to stay down. The reason you lean forward is so the horse gets up the hill with the least work. Now you're ready to go on a trail ride full of hills. Thank you for watching.
This is Paul Dunn from Mule City Feeds. We've been delivering horse feed to Eastern North Carolina since 1981. And not only have we been delivering it, we've been leading the industry so far as compliance with state North Carolina and giving the best quality product possible. We test everything that comes in from the local farmers. We do quality assurance and we deliver the product. Give us a chance. Your neighbor's giving us a chance. We'd like to have your business here at Mule City Feeds. Also, when you deal with the big feed companies, you might have to wait 4 or 5 days just to get the feed. Give us a call and you'll be shocked. We'll deliver in an hour.